Yes, sister, we can start.
Praise the Lord. Good evening, Brother Bryce, Father Marlon Rona, and all you brothers and sisters. Welcome to the Lord's Ranch on Zoom for this youth retreat. For those of you who have not been to the Lord's Ranch before or have not visited the Lord's Ranch Retreat Center, just a brief introduction. Lord's Ranch is located at Tau Village, Mulshi, at the backwaters of the Varasgaon Dam, amidst a scenic beauty that has been described by many as a slice of heaven on earth. The location is of great significance, for it is the very land chosen by the Lord Himself, provision executed by Brother Hilary de Vega. For a more detailed description of the vision, please visit our website, www.lordranch.org, and you will get the entire history of the vision and how and why the retreat center was started. Lord's Ranch was inaugurated on the 31st December 2006, and the Lord's Ranch Retreat Center started operating in 2008 as a result of a prophetic call to host retreats. The center hosts retreats in English, Marathi, Konkani, youth retreats, and personal retreats, all aimed with a view to reach out to one soul at a time, the mission of the Lord's Ranch. In 2010, the Lord's Ranch Youth Group, an international group, started on Facebook and was formally inaugurated in the year 2012 as a youth wing of the Lord's Ranch to carry out the mission of the Lord's Ranch to reach out to one soul at a time among their own generation. Manned by a crew of five co-members, the youth group aims to call, renew, evangelize their world in the universities, workplaces, etc. It is hoped that these 3 days of retreat will help all the participating youth to emerge stronger to face the challenges that are confronting them in present times. Our program will begin this evening with adoration, praise, and worship conducted by the Lord's Ranch Youth, meditation and talk by Brother Bryce, the Eucharistic celebration by Father Mylan, and of course, after a short, brief, interactive session, we will have the concluding prayer and a decade of the rosary led by the Lord's Ranch Youth. Devotion to Mother Mary has been an integral part of all retreats that take place on the Lord's Ranch. However, due to shortage of time, we will have just one decade, and we request all of you participating brothers and sisters to please continue the rosary at home with your families. We will now begin our adoration and praise and worship.
Hallelujah. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. We welcome you, the all youth, and thank you, Brother Bryce, for being with us. The word of God says in Luke chapter 1, verse 49, the Almighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. So we thank you, Lord, for this beautiful day. We praise you, God, as your word says, let all sing together for the greater glory of God. And we'll sing this beautiful song, praise him. Praise him in the morning, praise him in the noontime, praise him. So we'll sing this beautiful song, and I hope you all join together with one voice for the greater glory of God. We'll sing together.
Praise him in the morning, praise him in the noontime, praise him when the sun goes down. Praise him, praise him, praise him in the morning, praise him in the noontime, praise him, praise him, praise him when the sun goes down. Abba, Abba, Abba in the morning, Abba in the noontime, Abba, Abba, Abba when the sun goes down. Hallelujah, Amen, Hallelujah, Amen, Hallelujah, Amen, Hallelujah, 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 Amen. Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus in the morning, Jesus in the noontime, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus when the sun goes down. Spirit, Spirit, Holy Spirit, Spirit in the morning, Spirit in the noontime, Spirit, Holy Spirit, Spirit when the sun goes down. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah in the morning, hallelujah in the noontime, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah when the sun goes down. We praise him, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, thank you, Lord, thank you, Lord, thank you, Lord, thank you, thank you. Thank you, Father, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Holy Spirit, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. We love you, God. We praise you, God. We thank you, Lord, for everything. As your word says, Luke chapter 1, verse 37, there is nothing that God cannot do. Yes, Lord. We surrender our hearts into your hands, Lord. As your word says, my word is the lamp for your feet. Your word is lamp for my feet and light to my path. Psalm chapter 119, verse 105. Lord Jesus, open our heart today, Lord, for you, Lord. Lord Jesus, speak to us through our brother Bryce. And through your word of God, Lord. Lord Jesus, open our heart. We have nothing to give you, but we have our hearts. And Lord Jesus, we send our hearts to you. Bless us with your mighty Holy Spirit. Let's sing together this beautiful song. Open the eyes of my heart. Yes, God, open the eyes of our heart. We surrender ourselves. And we surrender
God, we look to you tonight, Lord. Above the singing, God, above
open
the music.
Open the eyes of my heart, oh Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high lifted up. Shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love. As we sing, holy, 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 I want to see you. Sing together. Open the eyes of my heart, O Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you. To see you high lifted up. Shining in the light of your glory, pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. We want to see you. We want to see you, Lord. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory, pour out your power and love. As we sing, holy, 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 we want to see you. We praise you, God. We thank you, God. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
Hallelujah, God. Thank you, God. Praise you, God. As your word says, 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 15, always thanks be to God for his unspeakable gift. Lord, we thank you for everything. We praise you, Lord. We have nothing to give you, but we are giving thanks to you, Lord. Everything is from you, God, and everything for your greater glory, O God. Lord Jesus, I pray for this retreat, Lord. Bless our heart, O Lord. Bless our minds. Bless our souls. As your word says, in any circumstances, give thanks to the Lord, because this is the will of Jesus Christ in you. Lord, we give thanks to you. We give glory to you. We give honor to you. We have nothing, O Lord, but we have our hearts, Lord. We are giving our hearts to you, Lord. Lord Jesus, we praise you. We thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah, God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah, God. We love you, God. We praise you. Praise you. Praise you, God. Praise you, God. Praise you, God. Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, God. Bible says it is a good thing to give thanks to the Lord. Lord Jesus, we give thanks to you. We praise you. We sing together this beautiful song for the greater glory of God. Hallelujah, God. Bible says it is a good thing to give thanks to the Lord. We sing together for the greater glory of God. Hallelujah, God. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I come before you today, and there's just one thing I want to say. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord, for all you have given to me, for all the blessing that I cannot see. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. With a grateful heart, with a song of praise, with an outstretched arm, I will bless your name. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. 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 We just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We praise you, God. Love you, God. Hallelujah, God. For some moment, we praise the Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit, Lord. Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah, Lord. Lord Jesus, we surrender ourselves into your hands. Speak to us through our brother Bryce and guide us with your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah, God. Praise you, God. Yes, Brother JP.
Yes, Brother.
So, good evening, all of you.
Good evening, Brother.
Good evening, Brother.
Good evening. Firstly, I'd like to thank Sister Adeline for giving us a short summary of Lord's Ranch. And also after that, Brother Akash, for the beautiful praise and worship. I'm very grateful that I got an opportunity to give this short retreat to our youth. This is also my first retreat after coming down from Philippines, where I did my theology. And I'm really happy that I got a chance to express myself to these young people. So without any delay, I think you all have seen my first slide. The theme of today's retreat is in your presence. I like the imagery of this image. You see, there are two people, Jesus and the young person, a boy or a girl, and both their faces are not seen. This is what I want you all to come into. In this retreat, let us discover how is Lord trying to reveal us the face of God in these 3 days. And in return, how will be our response to Him? How does my face reflect the face of Jesus? So this is what I'm inviting to. So it is not about the retreat center of Lord's Ranch or Brother Bryce or people around you, but it is about Jesus, who is going to touch you in this retreat. And we are just mere instruments to help you. So going ahead to our next slide. In our next slide, you will see I have given a little short requirements, like please to have in this 3 days a Bible with you, a writing pad, a diary, clean sheets of paper for notes and reflection. It's very important. We don't know when will God inspire us. When there was praise and worship, you got an insight. Put it down. Have some crayons, sketch pens, okay? Do some decoration, design, scribble around, whatever it is. We don't know how Spirit inspires us. With all these moments of 3 days, the things that Spirit is going to tell you all through each one of us, through various talks, reflections, please make sure you write it down. Have an open mind and heart, okay, as you all join in. Spend time in His presence. What do I mean by that? Spend time in His presence, like, not only this retreat time, but you will have something meditative mornings where you will have some meditation, which I have prepared. Then attuned afternoons, great stories from the Bible, something very beautiful stories, how God has intervened. Then you will have something eloquent evenings, the evenings that are there, and notable nights. At the end of the day, kindly summarize some beautiful things that the Lord has inspired you with. And lastly, be relaxed. And allow yourself to be disturbed by the Lord. So keeping all these things in mind, let us begin our first talk today. So as we move towards the next slide, the theme for today's talk is Lost and Found. Something, a very usual theme in the gospel. The very fact I'm taking this theme with you all is because Jesus says in Luke 15, these 3 parables about a sheep, a coin, and the son. And we'll unfold this theme. Why this theme is so precious to our dear Lord too. Wherever we see in Jesus' ministry, we see this theme coming up. Okay, to the next slide. To begin my talk, let me give you two stories. So there was this story of 2 families who were living in a neighborhood. And one family was very religious. Okay, they would go for mass, confession. They would go for retreats, and they educated their sons and daughters in faith. As you see, they were kneeling down in prayer. Just beside them, there is one more family. Dad is a drunkard. He harasses the family. He doesn't care about his children. And this drama goes on for quite a long years. So the family that is religious says to themselves, "We are a very good family. And see the family beside me. They don't go to the church, so I will not interfere with my life into their well-being. I will do what I have been doing. I'll go to the church and I will do my best." And they lived happily ever after, because the family in the neighborhood got changed. The family, which was a very disturbed family, they moved out, and there was one more family that came in, which was very sober. They used to go to church every day, and the story ends. Both family lived happily ever after. And there is a second story of a girl. All of us like to go to some museum park, SL World, or water parks, wherever. So there was this family that went to a place of rides. And while they are standing in the queue, the family realizes the girl is missing. And when they realize that their small girl is missing, everything comes to a standstill. because something very dear to them was lost. They forgot about the ride. They went in search for that girl. So these are the two stories which I am trying to keep in front of you all. My dear young people, keep the stories in mind, because the conclusions of the stories are going to come in my talk ahead. So let's start with the next slide. When we look in this entire scenario of lost and found, okay, what is missing? In all these three parables, what is missing? The sheep, the coin, and the son. But it's very interesting. When I told you the story, we know, like, the girl was missing, the family knew. It just shook their world. They went in search. At times, things are missing and we don't know. How is it? We wear our jeans, pants, or in our pocket, some money is left. Then suddenly when we go back to the pant and we wear it again, we come to know, all right, this thing which was missing, I have found it here. So there are things like that. Things that are missing, we know. And things that are missing, we don't know. What happens when you miss a wedding ring or a paycheck or dog, our own pet dog? We become restless. Life comes to a halt. But when we find something that was missing and we didn't know, life just moves on. We didn't even know it was missing. But a young child missing at a grocery store, you see the drama that happens. There is yelling, shouting, announcing on the intercom. The parents are restless. What is so different with things, with these two stories or these two ends? When we know, the thing is missing, and when we don't know, the thing is missing. There is something very different. And that's why that's my first question that I'm going to present to you in my next slide. Something missing which has value, we pursue. We will not go behind 1 rupee, 10 rupee, but something of worth, a wedding ring or something really very dear to us is missing, we pursue. We put our heart and soul. So this is my first question to you. It will be a poll. Have you missed or lost something of great value in your life? So you have to answer yes or no. Each one will have to answer it. Have you missed or lost something of great value in your life? Whatever it may be. Okay. Has everyone voted? Oh, 100%. Okay. Now, in your own diary or pen, can you write what it was? A person, a thing, whatever, just pen it down. What was it? Because when you know that thing was lost, you keep it as your great value. That is something we pursue. That is something we go in pursuit. So what is the meaning of pursue? Okay, the next slide. Pursue is something that we chase, we follow, we track, and we hunt. Okay? It's not something that we just live it by. We go after it. Keep this imagery in mind. The thing that you have lost, you had pursued it. Because that imagery is going to help you to understand this talk about lost and found. Why do the person, the Jesus, goes in search of this lost? So when things that are lost of great value, we pursue. The pursuit is different. Our pursuing is different. Our chase is different for the missing things to the value that it denotes. Greater the value, more the efforts involved. Lesser the value, we will not care about it. Okay? And that's how Jesus gives us these three parables. The next slide. Luke 15. Okay, we have these three beautiful parables: the parable of the lost sheep, the parable of the lost coin and the parable of the lost son or the prodigal son. You would be surprised that these three stories, Jesus especially says these three stories to the bunch of religious people who were around him. Why? Because Pharisees were asking him some questions like, why are you spending your time with these people around? These people like sinners, prostitute, destitute, Samaritans. Why are you spending your time with them? Why don't you spend your time around with us? So that is where these three parables, it's going to be very interesting how these three parables will unfold what Jesus values or for what Jesus had come down on earth. Okay, the next slide. So what does God value? When we look at these three parables, okay, in the next slide, we'll see what does God values. What is God trying to tell these Pharisees? Those who are learned, well-trained, well-established in their religious tradition. Jesus is trying to unfold to them all this while you knew things. But do you really know what God values? You have been around studying me. It happens with us sometimes, my dear young people. We go to church. We do all the things. But at the end, we forget what is God's call for us? Or what is that value? What is the thing that God is telling us to look deep inside? We might be only superficial Christians going around doing things but not allowing God to challenge us. So today, this talk or these three parables will unfold to us. What does God value? Going to our next slide. Next slide. As we know that Jesus was saying, okay, the sheep are funny, they are dancing. It's because the found sheep. That's the slide. Okay. So we knew that Jesus was addressing these three parables, not only the lost sheep of Israel, but also the found sheep. Who are these found sheep? They are the Pharisees, like also some of us, like we are well safe, well fed, we are protected, we are together, and we are secure. So here is where Jesus is trying to show the two ends of the spectrum. Something that is lost sheep and they are found sheep. And especially he's targeting this parable to this found sheep who are so comfortable around themselves, like the first family I told you. I gave you the example of the story. The family was well, they were not doing any harm, but they were not doing even any good. They were not doing what God was calling them to do. This is the found sheep that are so stagnant with practicing or with living their life that they think there is nothing much that we need to do. So even if we notice, like, we don't care about someone else, I'm looking at my own self, my own life. So it's Jesus is telling them, it's not about only selfishness of having God, selfishness of being perfect, or selfishness of being right. It's not about it. Kingdom of God is with all people around. People in the neighborhood, those who are your enemies, people in the neighborhood, those who are your friends. So it's about, so it's also called to this found sheep. It's also called to this found sheep to not be so comforted in their own safe zones of being a Christian, following a very devoted life. No, it's not only about that. It's saying you also have to make the effort to go beyond. And the next slide, we'll see Jesus gives us like what it means to go beyond. The next slide, we'll see that Jesus is showing the heart of the good shepherd. So Jesus encourages us to think, feel, touch, and walk with the heart of a good shepherd. Some of us, we pray daily. Okay, we pray daily. And let our prayer be this, like, God, give me this heart of a good shepherd. Not only about, Lord, I have done so many good things. Today, I didn't do any sin. So it's not about that. It's not about only our self-interest in the Lord, our spirituality with the Lord. My spirituality with the Lord. It is about us, all of us coming together. Let this be our prayer. Allow me to be the person that notices the missing sheep around me. Let me not be comfortable in being the found sheep. Let me be the person who pursues, who walks distance, no matter how messy or heavy the sheep is, or how far I have to. Sometimes it's so, in the friend circles we know, chal aate hai kya udhar, aate hai kya aap udhar, wo shop pe mere saath, so you'll say, no, it's too far, I don't want to go. You see, because it's not my need, it is my friend's need. And I'm not ready to walk that extra mile. Actually, Jesus gives that invitation for us to walk that extra mile. Walk that extra mile for that lost sheep, which is messy. At times when we hear the problems of people around, we don't want to interfere. My family is so safe. I am good. Everything is happening so well with me. So that is what also we realize in friendly conversations. So let us embrace this heart of a good shepherd who goes in search for the lost, who is not so comfortable by him being found. Okay, that makes a step ahead. Because Jesus wants more from us than just being found sheep. So okay, he is inviting us to reflect with the heart of a good shepherd. So there is the questionnaire for you all once again. Most of the time when we respond to people, how do we respond? With stony heart or with heart of flesh? What I mean, when people come to us, when friend approach us, how are we trying to respond to them? Do we have a listening heart or do we have a judgmental heart? Mere ko time nahi hai. Maja kade time nahi. I can't come. How is our heart? Or do we have our own work schedules that we go through? I don't have time. I have this class. I have that class. I'm busy. Am I available? Okay. So most of the time when we respond to people, how do we respond? Do we respond with a stony heart or with a heart of flesh? You can submit your answers.
You can see a questionnaire with option. You can just click on either A, stony heart, or B, heart of flesh. This is a compulsory question. So far we have received 6 responses. Everyone has to answer this. ~80%, yes. 20% you see on your screen. Yes, Radha, I'm ending this poll here right now and I'm sharing the answer with you. Yes, brother.
Okay, yeah. So 62% with a heart of flesh, 37% still with a stony heart. It's not bad, but it tells the reality of our own lives. It tells the reality of our own life. Why are our hearts not capable to reach out? It's because they have to be filled. They have to be filled. And to fill those hearts, they have to be empty. We always see the story of a crow putting stones in a bucket of water to sip the water. So if our hearts are filled with stones, I don't think the heart of flesh can enter. For that, we need to enter empty so that we can be filled with the Lord. But it was really nice, we all being frank about it. But each time, please keep that in mind. Like, as we go around with people, how do we relate with them? We relate with a blunt heart, like, I don't care. That is something like we are in a cult of, like, I don't care. You do what you want. After all, it affects you. But heart of flesh will go out, will reach out. No, that's wrong. Would you try this? Would you try that? So that is something we need to help in our friends, in our peer group. Or else if we just say, kar, tere ko jo karna hai, kar. It is just like a cold heart instead of a heart of flesh. Okay. Let's go to the next slide. So from this three parables, parable from these three parables of sheep, coin, and son, I have chose to give some reflection on the coin. Because you might have heard plenty of time about sheep. You might have heard also a lot of time the sermons of the son. But let me tell you about this lost coin. Today we'll reflect. Something that is lost in this story, it is found. We see people rejoicing. And there is little difference from the first story and the third story. Okay? So Jesus told this story for a purpose. And it wasn't for repetition. Okay? These three stories in Luke's chapter 15 are like a trilogy. Okay? It's like a series, set, or a sequence. So when Jesus tells this second story, he assumes you know the first. Okay? He assumes you know the points and textures of the first story, and he will add something new in this second. What he's going to add is the depth. He's going to add more depth to the story. And all of it together is building towards the climax. And that is the third story. So whatever you might have known about this first and the third story, please keep those things in mind. It will help you to understand, or it will help us to reflect on the second story of the missing coin. Okay, so the second story will add more depth and nuance. Okay, it is a story from Luke chapter 15. Okay, those who have your Bibles can just open your Bibles and screen it through. Okay, the story is very simple. Okay, the story is the next slide. The story is very simple. It's a parable which Jesus says. Jesus says this parable that a woman who has lost her coin, okay, she searches for it, and when she finds this coin, she rejoices. Now, what is this coin? Okay, loses coin. Okay, it's a silver coin. Okay, in Greek, it is drachma. Okay, the coin that was missing, it's drachma. This drachma is equivalent to one day's wages for an average laborer. Okay, what do you see? Average laborer earning around 500 to 600 rupees. So it is worth of that. Okay, it's not like one paisa or one rupee. Okay, it is one day worth, one day's worth work. Okay, so it's not a kind of wealth which is too much at times, but it's also kind of wealth. It's for a day, a personal work. So that is that drachma. Okay, next slide. Now. Yes, we go to the next slide. Yeah. Now, this woman, I told you, it's not that of something big money. It's a one day's work. Why do she go in search of this coin? So as you see in the picture, the woman is wearing the coin on the head. So there are these 10 coins. And from this 10 coin, there is that one coin that is lost. The drachma. Let me tell you, my dear young people, what is this? What is this coin? What does this coin signify? Okay. So this coin around her head is of very importance for her. Okay. Because if the wife displeases her husband or disgraces him or is unfaithful to him, the husband would remove this coin from her head. As to say to her, you are of no value. Or you are no more valuable to me as you used to be. And she would be forced to walk around the town or go to the well, visit her friends, her own family, or go back to her own house as a constant reminder that this was a woman who lost her value. So are you coming to know what is this thing like? In our today's terminology, we can call it Mangal Sutra or the ring, wedding ring. So this is something of great value that the woman has lost. Okay, it's of great value. It's like a wedding gift. And so she goes in person. She goes in person. Next slide. So as we know, why does she go in pursuit? Because the coin that was lost was of great value. It was of great value. And it had to be worth pursuing. Okay, she would have to walk in town in disgrace if she didn't have that coin. So Jesus was speaking this story. Okay, you see now, you imagine the scenario. Jesus was speaking this story. Pharisees were listening, even the tax collectors, and even perhaps those women sitting at the feet of Jesus were the ones missing the coin. So this coin is much more valuable than just $100, what we are talking about. It is something given to her by her in-laws during the time of her marriage, and that is what she has to preserve. So it represents that she is a person who is worth being pursued of. She is a person of great value. So when the coin is missing, she begins this search because it represents an incredible value. Okay, next slide. So it's like that, a woman who lost her value. That's why she has to go in search of it. So now if you see some of our coins, do you have a coin before you? Any coin? I'm showing you my coin, what coin I have. Okay, so this is 1 rupee coin. A coin that I have. I may not go in search for this coin because it doesn't denote so much things to me and it is not of great value. Okay, so the woman chasing her, as you know, it is of great value. Okay, the next slide. So as we look in this parable, as I told you, parables are filled with a lot of metaphors. So let us look the characters in this parable. Okay, the characters in this parable. The next slide. Woman. So as you see, the woman is the one searching. So woman in this parable represents Jesus. It would be shocking to Pharisees. Like Jesus is comparing himself with a woman. A woman was something in their time next to animal or the property of the husband. It would be also scandalous. Men and women having the same value. A religious teacher equating himself with this would tell that words of volume. So you see Jesus comparing himself with a woman, also showing that, see, this is how he goes in search. Like the value that he has for the missing sheep or the missing son. Okay, this is a search because Jesus is not going to something which is of less value. He's going after something which is of great value to him. And the 9 coins, the next slide, the 9 coins represents the Pharisees or the religious leaders or the worshippers. They think they have a heart after the things of God. Okay, they are very suitable, comfortable in their own place. Like that. And the missing coin, the next slide. Missing coin would be relating to all the missing children of Israel. It would be relating to you and me. Okay, those sitting at the feet of Jesus. That is something of missing coin. It is rich in imagery. The next slide. So now, my dear young people, that is a questionnaire for you all. How is value determined of a person? A, who he is. B, where he is. This is a poll for you. You will have to vote. Okay. How is a value determined of a person? A, who he is. B, where he is. Even I am voting. Okay, have everyone answered?
Not yet.
Okay.
77% have voted.
Don't have to think so much. It's a very simple question. How do you determine a person's value?
Everyone has to compulsory answer this question.
Don't worry, we don't know who is answering what, but we get an overall percentage. You don't have to be afraid. Okay, are we done?
Yes, brother.
Oh, 85% have answered A, who he is, and 14% have answered where he is. Okay. Value is determined by who we are. and not where we are. Okay, let me give an example. The value of a person staying in a building or the value of a person staying in a hut, it doesn't determine its value. Okay, we don't count where he is, but who he is. He is a child of God. So we get a value by the Creator, not by where we are, the post that we held, we have with us. It's not about that, where we are, but who we are. Okay, so drachma on the head of this woman is worth chasing, because it's not only about a one missing coin. It is of much more value to her. The value doesn't change because things are missing. Keep that in mind. Value will not change because the thing is missing. It doesn't gain value simply because it is found. So as we are contemplating on this lost and found, keep in mind the value is with itself. The value is with the lost. The value is with the found sheep. The value is with them. It doesn't change because it is lost and found. Okay, the next slide. Okay, so as I told you, I had grabbed a coin. Okay, what do you see on a coin? Coin bears the imprint of generally where it was made, the place it represents, the place, and it also represents something about the security and the value of the coin. So if you all have a coin, can you just look at a coin? Okay, it will say its value. Yeah, definitely it's giving it. And also the backing of it, Government of India. So you see the backing of it, the backing of the value of this coin. So tomorrow, if you want to know who has made this coin, there is a backing of it, as you also see in the slide. Okay, there is a backing. Now, Genesis 1:26. If you all have Bibles, can you all go to it? Because there is a...
Hello,
can you hear me? Hello,
I can hear you, brother. I can hear you.
Okay, so now value of the coin. What is the value of human being? Okay, what is the value of a human being? Go to Genesis 1:26. We find our values over there. Okay, it's not how we are looking at with different expensive things or luxurious life that we have got. But in Genesis 1:26, it is said, God says, let us make mankind in our own image. Male and female, he created them. He made them in his image, which means all of us created by the Lord have the inherent value and dignity which comes from God's image. The lost sheep, the lost coin, or the lost son. Our value doesn't change when we are lost. Our value doesn't diminish if we are sinners or if we have lost the way. God, who commissioned us, okay, he says, I will back the value of this coin. I will back the value of humanity. And what does he do? He dies for us on the cross just to back this value. At times we look at the life of others, how good they are, what good families they have. And we look at our lives. I'm not good as him or her. We see our own, in our peers, like they have so devoted families, they have such a healthy family life, but my dad, my mom, they're not there for me. But keep in mind, my dear young people, the value still exists. God values us. It's not that God is valuing them more. God is giving them more blessing. No. It's not that. In whatever situation we are, God is with us. And that's why I've given you that title, I am with you always. Okay? This story says that wherever we are, in whichever place, the value doesn't change. Okay? Next slide. So my dear young people, wherever you find yourself today, God values you. Wherever you find yourself today, God values you. Suicide, depression, these are not the answers to the problems. Okay, wherever you have been, in his presence, you would realize your own value. So if you know the value already exists, and this is so important to know that ourselves, sometimes always we compare ourselves among the found sheep and the lost sheep. So Jesus tells us, like, how much worth is life all about? It's not only about lost and found, but it's about that he values you. Okay? This exact same amount, the value of a found sheep is that of a lost sheep. Okay? So you can see in your own houses or in your own compartments, when you see poor people, the maid servants who work in our houses, it's the same value as you have. It's not because you're paying them more, you're rubbing on your value on them. No, but it's the same. So God values you. Never forget that. Next slide. Okay. Again, coming back to the parable. The coin is missing and the woman goes in search. It's so important. How was this search? So she knows the coin is missing now. Okay, the coin is missing. How is she going to search? There are three things that she does, and these three things will also highlight the character of God. How does he approach us? So what is the first thing that she does? Okay, next slide. What is the first thing that she does is she gets a lamb and lets it. It may be nighttime. She didn't wait for the morning. She began quickly, immediately. The pursuit is immediate. Okay. She didn't wait for the circumstances to change. She burned valuable oil to go in search for the lost coin. Because what the coin represented was great value. Once again, she didn't wait for the circumstances to change. She changed the circumstances. At times, we just wait for the right time until we are asked. I will wait till I'm stronger. I will wait till I grow older. I will wait when I have lots of money. No, my dear young people. It was a pursuit that she just went through. She didn't wait for it. Okay. Next, the second feature of her. Next slide. She got a broom. Okay. To reach to the places where her hand couldn't reach. Also, the coin may not get lost in dirt. See the precaution. She got a broom. She was not doing only with the hand. She got a broom. She was willing to go beneath the surface to bend down. Because she valued something that was missing. And you see exactly the same with Jesus. He was willing to bend down, carry the cross, put himself as a suffering servant, just for our sake, the value that we have, for our value. Okay? So my dear young people, we have this tendency. At times when we lose things, we go and search in the obvious places. And we say, I have searched everywhere. No, we haven't. Because sometimes things are not always in the obvious places. Okay? So what about people in our life that we value? Are we looking in the proper places as we pursue them? Next slide. And the third thing, what she does. She searched carefully, meticulously. Diligently, wall to wall, very, very, very persistent about searching this. The point is not to get the house cleaned, okay? The point of her is not to get the house cleaned, but to find something of worth. So I would say it was a wise, intentional pursuit that demonstrated the value. She cared. The question is not about why is she going in search with so much. The question is about, there is something of value that she is missing and she wants. Okay. And Jesus is asking the same question for all of us today. Why don't we pursue people who Jesus values? And this pursuit should not be like, I tried my best, but he didn't listen to me. This pursuit has to be extremely loving, wise, and with intentionality. Okay. Next slide. the last point of my talk, which I want to make, is which Jesus makes in this second story. Okay, the person that's missing may not be far away. What is the meaning of that? You don't have to be gone to be missing. Okay, you don't have to be gone to be missing. At times we may be lost in our own places where we are. We might have been so comfortable in our own homes, in our own lodgings, whatever things we do in our own choir group, that at times we think, okay, I am with the Lord. No. You see, in the first story, the sheep wandered off. Okay. In the second story, coin never leaves the home. The coin is just there. So it was right there the whole time. Maybe that's also the story of our life. Okay. You and I, all of us, might have counted ourselves in, like among the found coins. Because of many things that we do, we attend masses, prayer. Yet the truth is not only in being found or being in church, being in prayer or being a Christian. It is about the relationship with Jesus Christ. He told these stories also to Pharisees who had always been around the temple practicing the law, the Torah. But it had kept their hearts so stony that they didn't go out in search for this lost sheep. Next slide. There is a nice quote of Christopher West. He says, "Why was Christ so compassionate towards sexual sinners, especially women? Think of the women caught in adultery. Think of the prostitute who wept at his feet. Could it be because Christ knew that these women who had been deceived by counterfeit lovers were actually looking for him, the true bridegroom?" Okay? So at times, this is the irony of this story. Found people are missing the point of Jesus. This found sheep have really missed out. Like, what is Jesus about? They were so close to him, but they didn't know how Jesus would function. So Jesus would pursue even after his death, to resurrection. He came alive to Peter, to his apostles, and gave them the Holy Spirit. So he gives us a relationship. Are we willing to take it? Okay. We might have been around Christ our whole life. Okay. But Jesus reminds us, when lost people allow themselves to be carried home, okay, they allow him to pay the price for his sin, or his sins, there is a lot of rejoicing in heaven and on. Okay. So the next slide, I would leave you all with these three questions. Okay, you all can note it down. Who do we mirror the heart of? Who do we mirror the heart of? Okay, mirroring the heart of my own self, and we have to see, like, what are the wrongs, what are the goods in our own self, or the good shepherd. Okay, what did the good shepherd do? In this present time of crisis, ask God, what would a wise, intentional person look like? You know, my dear young people, we are really going through a very tremendous crisis times. People don't have food to eat. Okay, people are moving out, they are migrating. What has been our, what would a good shepherd do? Okay, let me just put it that. What would a good shepherd do? Keeping all the precautions in mind. Okay, moments in which, the third question, moments in which I felt Jesus was there. I feel every found sheep has a story of himself being lost. If we don't go back to those moments, at times we may forget that we need to get more lost sheep which are away from the sheepfold into God's kingdom. So as we contemplate on these three questions, also keep in mind, we need to value what Jesus values. We need to pursue what Jesus pursues. In practical terms, follow the heart of the Good Shepherd. Okay? And the last slide I would end with the four P's. Pursued people, pursue people. If God has reached out to you, I hope and I pray that you and I reach out to people out there. Thank you for staying so attuned to my talk. And surely tomorrow you will get a PDF of meditation. Then in afternoon, you will get one more PDF of the stories that could help you in this entire reflection. Thank you.
God bless. Hallelujah. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. That the Lord has made. We will rejoice. We will rejoice and be glad in it. And be glad in it. For this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
We will rejoice and be glad in it.
We will rejoice and be glad in it. We are the people that the Lord has made.
We will rejoice and be glad in it.
For this is the Eucharist that the Lord has made.
Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Praise you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah. Glory, Father God. Hallelujah, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, yeah. The Lord is the strength of his people, a saving refuge for the one he has anointed. Save your people, Lord, and bless your heritage, and govern them forever. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
With your spirit.
With your spirit.
Well, to be honest, I celebrated Mass with a guitar in my hand, but I've never had the opportunity of celebrating Mass with earphones around my neck. So this is definitely a first. It's a nice, pleasant experience to celebrate this Holy Eucharist for each one of you. And I offer this Eucharist for all your intentions. In return, or as part of your prayers during this Eucharist, I ask you to pray for all of us who are conducting this retreat for you. And also, I have a very special intention. Yesterday, one of my companions was introduced into the Jesuit congregation. He made his first profession. I'd like you in a very special way to pray for him, that as he has embarked on this very special journey, that the Lord may always be with him. With all these intentions in mind, let us move on into this celebration of the Holy Eucharist. I'm sure each one of you, wherever you are, in whichever part of the country or the world, while traveling, have come across what are known as emergency exits in vehicles. In our luxury buses, we usually have them towards the end of the bus. In trains, you have those windows without the grills. And they're meant precisely so that in case of an emergency, you have an alternative means to get out of what could be a life endangering or a very difficult situation. In today's first reading, taken from the book of Kings, you have God giving the people of Israel the opportunity of using an emergency exit. It gives a historical account as to why the people of Israel deserved to be punished by God for their disobedience, for moving away from God's law. And yet, although justified in punishing the people of Israel, God provides them with an emergency exit. He says, if you turn away from your wicked ways, if you follow my commandments, then you will be spared. The emergency exit offered to the people of Israel is the same that is offered to each one of us today. Whenever we falter, whenever we move away from God, there is always this emergency exit to come back closer to God. No matter how much we think we do not deserve his saving grace, he always provides us with an opportunity to come back to him. And it simply means repenting and following his law. For the many times in our lives when we have failed or we have not had the courage to turn back from our sinful ways, for the times when we have failed to follow his commands, let us ask God for his pardon and mercy, and thus prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty
God,
and to you, my brothers and sisters,
that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words,
and what I have done,
and in what I have failed to do. Through my faults,
through my most grievous faults, therefore, I ask all the angels and saints, and to you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Let us pray. Let us bring before the Lord all the intentions that we hold close to our hearts. Grant, O Lord, that we may always revere and love your holy name, for you never deprive of your guidance those you set firm on the foundation of your love. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the second book of the Kings. The king of Assyria invaded the whole country, and coming to Samaria, laid siege to it for 3 years. In the 9th year of Hoshea, the king of Assyria, captured Samaria and deported the Israelites to Assyria. He settled them in Halal, on the harbor, a river of Gozan, and in the city of the Medes. This happened because the Israelites had sinned against the Lord their God, who had brought them out of the land of Egypt, out of the grip of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. They worshipped other gods. They followed the practices of the nations that the Lord had deposed for them. And yet, through all the prophets and all the seers of the Lord had given Israel and Judah this warning: turn from your wicked ways and keep my commandments and my laws in accordance with the entire law I laid down for your fathers and delivered to them through my servants, the prophets. But they would not listen. They were more stubborn than their ancestors had been, who had no faith in the Lord their God. They despised his laws and the covenant he had made with their ancestors and the warnings he had given them. For this, the Lord was enraged with Israel and thrust them away from him. There was none left but the tribe of Judah only. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our response, hear us.
Desire and I long to
with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory be to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not judge, and you will not be judged. Because the judgments you give are the judgments you will get. And the amount you measure out is the amount you will be given. Why do you observe the splinter in your brother's eye and never notice the plank in your own? How dare you say to your brother, 'Let me take the splinter out of your eye,' when all the time there is a plank in your own? Hypocrite, take the plank out of your own eye first, and then you will see clearly enough to take the splinter out of your own brother's eye." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
My brothers and sisters, the reflection I'm going to share with you is something I came across and which, quite honestly, to a certain extent, scared me. In today's gospel, Jesus speaks about the favorite time pass of humankind, namely finding fault with other people. And while you may say, no, this is not our favorite time pass, just think about it. Most of the time, this is exactly what we are doing. And it's this habit that cuts across people of all generations and all ages. I'm not sure how frequently it happened before the lockdown, but definitely during the lockdown, you would have caught yourselves watching a lot of TV. And if you're watching the news, you will realize you will have the adults in the room saying, oh, the government can do this, can do that, should do this, should do that. And in fact, they themselves are doing probably very little to help the situation. Think about people who are watching sports. How often do we catch ourselves watching a cricket match and then telling ourselves, oh, that batsman should have hit the ball on this side instead of hitting it that side, or while watching football saying, well, the guy is being paid almost $1 million per week. How can he miss such a simple goal? Often when it comes even to our friends, when they get into trouble, we catch ourselves saying, oh, this guy should have done this, or this one should have done that. It's a natural tendency for each one of us to always find faults with others. Well, I told you there was something about this reflection that was scary, and for that, I'd like to lead you into a very simple exercise. 3 steps. Step one. I want you to think of at least 3 persons whom you really can't stick. Someone who the moment you see them, your blood begins to boil. Someone who, even if they smile, it angers you. Someone, no matter what they say, infuriates you, brings out the worst in you. Think of around or at least 3 such persons, giving you a few seconds to sieve through all the people you know and probably come up with 3 persons who would fit the criteria. Maybe a family member, maybe a friend, maybe an enemy you've been holding for a very long time. Maybe someone you just know, an irritating neighbor. If you've managed to accomplish this first task, even if you've got just 1 person in mind, step 2. What is that characteristic or quality in that person which really gets on your nerves? Identify that one quality. Maybe the person is stubborn, the person may be inconsiderate, the person may be insensitive, the person may have a very irritating habit, maybe the person's way of going about, the person always finds some weakness in you. Can be anything, maybe something very, very simple. And if you've had enough time for completing step 2, here's the scary one, and that's step 3. Check if that quality is part of your person as well. It's very interesting, but very often the things that we hate the most in others are things that we find in ourselves. The first time I came across this, I said, this is not true. There are things in other people that I hate, which definitely I don't have in me. For example, I know there was this friend of mine who used to smoke, because of which I couldn't get along with the guy. And I said, I do not smoke. Smoking is something that I hate in the other person. But then it dawned on me, it was not the smoking that really affected me. It was actually the fact that the person was not listening to me, that the person was stubborn, that really got on my nerves. And then when I began to think about it, I realized, well, when it comes to being stubborn, I too deserve quite a prize in being stubborn. It was similar with the case with other people. Persons whom I irritated because they were proud helped me realize that I myself was proud. Persons whom I got angry with because they were probably persons who were show-offs, who did things for people to recognize them. I realized I had those qualities within me, even if I was not aware of them. And I realized this is the case with almost all of us, even when it comes to persons we have hated for a very long time. I'm reminded of this classmate of mine in the 7th standard. She was a girl who, for some reason or the other, we always got into fights. There were times when I made her cry. There was a time when even the class teacher cried. And years later, when I became a teacher, I realized making the class teacher cry when you are a 7th standard student is quite an accomplishment. But to cut a long story short, after nearly a decade, I happened to meet that girl again. Of course, during this time, I had grown and I had a lot of time for reflection. I was not yet a priest. I was still a brother. And after a long conversation with her, talking about many things, as I was walking her to the gate, I apologized to her for being such a jerk 10 years ago. And I said, I don't know. At that point of time, when I was a 7th standard kid, I was proud. I was stubborn. I was stupid. And I shouldn't have done the things I did. And to my surprise, she turned to me and said, well, Mylan, to be honest, those were the same qualities I had within me. I was proud. I was stubborn. I was quite stupid. And that is what I thought I hated in you. Jesus is no psychologist, but he knows the heart. And therefore, when in today's gospel, he says, you're a hypocrite for finding fault with others when you have a plank in your own eye, it makes a lot of sense. Because he knows that deep within our hearts, what we identify as something bad in the other person, what we identify as a fault or a weakness in another person, is probably something buried deep down in our own selves. I remember one of my superiors, one of the priests in charge of us, once telling us, often when you find fault in others, you are actually self-projecting your problems on them. And I realized years later, it is so true of each one of us. At the same time, Jesus is not saying, don't find fault with others. If you are a parent, there are times you need to identify and correct faults with your children. As a good friend, as a companion, there will be instances when you will have to confront your friends when they do something wrong and tell them to mend their ways. That is being truly Catholic. But at the same time, we need to follow the 3 steps I just told you. Who, what, and do I have that problem within myself? We need to introspect before we begin to identify and correct the faults in others. Therefore, during this Eucharist, let us ask Jesus for this grace, that as we choose to introspect and mend our ways, we may be able to identify the things that we hate in others and check whether we have those things within ourselves, and ask him for the strength and nourishment so that we may overcome these weaknesses and with his grace grow closer to him.
we move on to the offertory.
The sun cannot compare to the glory of your love. There is no shadow in your presence. No mortal man would dare to stand before your throne.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and for the good of all his holy church.
Receive, O Lord, the sacrifice of conciliation and praise, and grant that cleansed by its action, we make an offering of our heart pleasing to you, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Father most holy, through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, the Word through whom you made all things, whom you sent as our Savior and Redeemer, incarnate by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin, fulfilling your will and gaining for you a holy people, he stretched out his hands as he endured his passion, so as to break the bonds of death and manifest the resurrection. And so with the angels and all the saints, we declare your glory. As with one voice, we acclaim.
Holy,
holy, holy, holy, holy, holy Lord,
God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you destroyed our life.
Jesus, come in glory. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, Oswald our Bishop, his auxiliaries and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be coerced to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen. 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 Amen.
As one family gathered round the table of the Lord, let us pray the words our Savior gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. Lead us not into temptations, but deliver us from all evil. Amen.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace in unity and accordance with your will. We live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Peace be with you, Father. Peace be with you all.
Peace be with you.
Lamb of God,
take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord,
I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof,
but only
say a word, and my soul shall be healed.
Spiritual communion prayer. My Jesus,
Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things.
I love you.
I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Sins away, slain for us. And we remember the promise made that all who come in faith find forgiveness at the cross. So we share. So we share in this bread. Sacrifice.
The eyes of all look to you, Lord, and you give them their food in due season. Let us pray. Renewed and nourished by the sacred body and precious blood of your Son, we ask of your mercy, O Lord, that what we celebrate with constant devotion may be our sure pledge of redemption to Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks
be to God. Thanks be to God.
I still
Jesus. Brother, we can say the closing prayer and then we will start with the rosary.
Okay, praise the Lord. We're saying the closing prayer, Nina. Okay, firstly, let me thank Brother Bryce and Father Myra. Thank you so much for your valuable contribution, for being a part of this online retreat of the Lord's Ranch. Thanking is a very small thing to do. We really need to thank our God for you, because God has chosen you to be his instruments, to touch the lives of some of the youth who are listening to you today. Thank you for the beautiful homily, Father, and thank you for spending this time with us today. We also thank Brother Akash and Sister Veronica. Thank you for being a part and the support of the Lord's Ranch, for always being there to do the work of the Lord and to glorify him. Amen. In our life, we have many, many opportunities given to us by our God. And it would be really heartbreaking to know that someday we missed on those opportunities. However small they are, we need to take hold of every opportunity that God gives us to glorify him on the face of this earth. We do not know how many more are left, but we know of those which God has given us to glorify him. And if you know what Jesus says, the last moment, he says, Father, glorify your son with the glory that I had with you from the beginning. And the Father says, I've already glorified myself. So we are here to glorify our God. Let's just close our eyes and look at our God being glorified in our lives today. Father, in the name of Jesus, we simply want to thank you today for giving us this beautiful opportunity to glorify you. There are many, many youth, God, who have not been able to attend or to spend this time with you today. But we thank you for giving us this opportunity today. We thank you that you are in total control of the lives, of our lives and the lives of those who couldn't make it here today. We pray for them today, God. We pray that you open their eyes and their ears. We pray that you reach out to them, my God. Because your word says, he who comes to you, you will in no wise cast out, my God. Lord, we thank you that we have not chosen you, but you have chosen us. And thank you that your choice will not be in vain. Thank you that your choice that you have made, you know what you have chosen, my God. You know why you have chosen us, my God. Not because we are better than anybody else, but we needed your embrace, Lord, today. We needed your tap to hear that, well done, good and faithful servant, for us to continue on our journey, my God. Thank you, God, for hearing our prayer today. Thank you, God, for answering us. Thank you, God, for all those who will be attending tomorrow and the day after tomorrow. And thank you, God, for the future that you have in store for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen, Father. Praise you, God.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit, God.
Hallelujah.
Brothers and sisters, we will now recite the decade, just one decade of the rosary. And we request you to continue the rosary at home. Devotion to Mother Mary has always been an integral part of every retreat on the Lord's Ranch. Those of you who want to know a little more about the role that Mother Mary has played on the ranch, please go to our website and you will see the beautiful statue of Mother Mary, the testimonies and the wonders that she has been working in the lives of youth in particular. Hina, can we start the rosary now? We don't have much time.
Yes, we'll sign ourselves in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Apostle Creed, I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered on the Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell on the third day, rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father, mighty. From there He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of body and life everlasting. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptations, but deliver us from all evil. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary,
Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners
now and at the hour of death. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be. O my Jesus, forgive us and save us from the fires of hell. Lead all souls to heaven, especially those who are most in mercy.
The five joyful mysteries. The first joyful mystery, the Annunciation. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us to temptation, but deliver us from all evil. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God,
pray for us sinners now and at the hour of death. Amen.
Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary,
Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death.
Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us now and at the hour of our death.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us at the hour of our death.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.